we've talked about glycolysis, and remember that glycolysis is really the only first step in the full oxidation of glucose. Next comes pyruvate oxidation, then the Krebs cycle, and finally we'll have electron transport and chemiosmosis. And then we'll really see the power of using oxygen as a final electron acceptor in generating vast amounts of ATP per molecule of glucose oxidized. So remembering, at the end of glycolysis, we ended up with two pyruvate molecules. And assuming that we are in an aerobic organism that is using oxygen to run the final steps of oxidation of glucose, that pyruvate will now enter the next step, which is pyruvate oxidation. Before we do that, however, I would like to do one more thing, and that is introduce you to some of the key players, some of which you've already seen. Of course, you're familiar with ATP. Here's adenine, here's the ribose sugar, and here is our three phosphates, which the breaking off of one phosphate of which releases energy that can power catalysis. So ATP is the energy currency molecule of the cell. And here we have NAD, which you've seen in glycolysis as accepting two electrons and a proton to become NADH. And you'll note that, hold on just a second, you'll note that NAD basically looks a lot like, has the root, if you will, of ATP, which is ADP. Here I'm circling ADP here now. So we'll change that to DP. Forget this phosphate out here. You'll see ADP. And NAD looks a lot like ADP, except that it has another nucleotide out here. So this has the root of ADP. And here we're going to see two more players, FAD and coenzyme A. Coenzyme A, you'll notice, also has a root molecule, if you will, that is ADP. Yes, there's another phosphate here. We won't worry about that. But essentially, coenzyme A has the basic structure of ADP plus this hydrocarbon ending in a sulfur here, in a sulfur group out here. And that sulfur will be key in the role that coenzyme plays in shuffling two carbon intermediates around. We'll see coenzyme A as a key player. We'll come across that. And then FAD can be reduced, just like NAD plus can be reduced, FAD can be reduced to FADH2. And look at FAD. It also has the root of ADP as its base. And another structure out here, similar to NAD, but slightly different. So both FAD and NAD are great electron transporters. They can accept electrons, and they act as cofactors to enzymes and will donate electrons and oxidize compounds in return. So we'll see all these molecular players in the oxidation, the full oxidation of glucose. And I just think it's interesting to note that the root base structure for all these molecules is ADP, and points to kind of a common evolutionary origin of some of these processes. So let's go to pyruvate oxidation now. End of glycolysis, we have two molecules of pyruvate, and that the oxidation of pyruvate occurs in the mitochondria, in the mitochondrial matrix, that is inside the inner mitochondrial membrane. So pyruvate must be transferred to the mitochondrial matrix, because remember, pyruvate is generated in the cytoplasm in glycolysis. So we must transport pyruvate across two mitochondrial membranes to get it into the matrix of the mitochondria, where it will be oxidized. Now, that is for eukaryotic cells that have mitochondria. In prokaryotes, which don't have mitochondria, this all occurs at the plasma membrane in prokaryotes. So in mitochondria, the enzyme complex that is responsible for oxidizing pyruvate is pyruvate dehydrogenase, and it consists of about 60 subunits of protein that come together. It's a large multi-enzyme complex, and that's what catalyzes the oxidation of pyruvate. Now, what happens when we oxidize pyruvate? We generate 1 CO2. You'll remember that pyruvate is pyruvate is a three-carbon molecule, has three carbons in it. We took glucose at the beginning of glycolysis. We took glucose, which is a six-carbon molecule. We split it into 2 3-carbon molecules, and we end up with pyruvate, 2 pyruvates then, each of which are 3-carbon molecules. Well, when pyruvate is oxidized, every molecule of pyruvate yields one of its carbons up as carbon dioxide. So we release carbon dioxide, and therefore we produce a 2-carbon product. Also in oxidation of pyruvate, we reduce NAD plus to NADH. So we have NAD plus plus 2 electrons plus a hydrogen, a proton, that yields NADH. NAD then becomes reduced to NADH, and pyruvate becomes oxidized. And finally, we end up, the last product of pyruvate oxidation is one molecule of acetyl coenzyme A. And acetyl coenzyme A has 2 carbons that come from pyruvate. One is lost as carbon dioxide. 2 carbons from pyruvate are attached to coenzyme A, and we call that resulting compound acetyl coenzyme A. Acetyl implies acetate, and acetate is the acetic acid is a small hydrocarbon. Here's the acid group on acetate. So whenever you see acetyl, you think of a 2-carbon situation. So we have 2 carbons attached to coenzyme A at that sulfur atom that I mentioned before. And then acetyl coenzyme A will carry the 2 carbons that derived ultimately from pyruvate into the Krebs cycle in the matrix of the mitochondrion, as we will see. But first, let's look at pyruvate oxidation. So out in the cytoplasm, we had glycolysis. The pyruvate resulting from glycolysis is transported into the matrix of the mitochondrion, and where pyruvate becomes oxidized, forming acetyl coenzyme A, which will then carry carbons into the Krebs cycle. And here is the pyruvate oxidation reaction. Here is pyruvate. There's 3 carbons on pyruvate, and pyruvate is oxidized to acetyl coenzyme A, and 2 of the carbons become attached to coenzyme A at the sulfur atom. So this then is acetyl coenzyme A. Here's coenzyme A, and then here's the acetyl group donated by pyruvate. And as this oxidation takes place, the carbon that is lost from pyruvate to form a 2-carbon acetyl coenzyme A is lost as carbon dioxide. So we've generated one molecule of carbon dioxide. When we respire, when we breathe out carbon dioxide. And this is one of the sources of carbon dioxide yielded by the oxidation of sugars, by the oxidation of glucose. In the process of oxidizing pyruvate to acetyl coenzyme A, we reduce a molecule of NAD to NADH. So for every molecule of pyruvate oxidized to acetyl coenzyme A, one molecule of NADH is produced by the reduction of NAD plus. And then the acetyl coenzyme A will carry the two carbons from derived ultimately from pyruvate. It will carry those 2 carbons into the Krebs cycle, and there the acetyl group from pyruvate will be oxidized. So let's just go back and look at this. We started with glucose with 6 carbons. We generated 2 3-carbon compounds that are pyruvate. And each of those pyruvate molecules now loses a carbon in the form of carbon dioxide when pyruvate is oxidized. So we've lost, for each pyruvate losing a carbon, we've lost 2 of the original carbons that were originally present in glucose. And those two carbons are lost as carbon dioxide. So in our accounting, we will take that, we must consider that. And we're going to do some energy accounting in a few minutes here. So keep that in mind. So the Krebs cycle occurs in the matrix of the mitochondria, as we've mentioned. And it is a biochemical pathway of 9 steps in which the 2 carbons donated by pyruvate to acetyl coenzyme A plus oxaloacetate, which is a 4-carbon compound. Oxalo is basically acetic acid. Whenever you see acetate or lactate, anything ends in 8, that is an acid. So this is another way of saying oxaloacetic acid. Citrate is citric acid. So these 2 carbons carried by acetyl coenzyme A plus oxaloacetate with 4 carbons yield citrate, that is citric acid, a 6-carbon molecule. And this occurs in the first step of the Krebs cycle. So the 2 carbons are joined to oxaloacetate to form a 6-carbon molecule. And we have citric acid or citrate produced in the first step of the Krebs cycle. The Krebs cycle is also known as the citric acid cycle because citrate or citric acid is the first intermediate produced in the Krebs cycle. And now we're ready to consider what happens in the remaining parts of the Krebs cycle before we look at the biochemical pathway itself. So in the remaining steps of the Krebs cycle, in order to keep our accounting straight, let's introduce this and we'll review it later. 2 more molecules of CO2 are reduced for every 2-carbon acetyl coenzyme A, the 2 carbons ultimately being derived from pyruvate. For every one of those 2 carbon molecules that enter the Krebs cycle, 2 molecules of CO2 are released. So we'll see how that works. And so then we will see that given the molecule of CO2 that was released in pyruvate oxidation, we then end up with 3 CO2s released, 3 carbons released as gas, as carbon dioxide, per molecule of pyruvate that's being oxidized. And that would be 6 molecules of CO2 per molecule of glucose then, because remember, glucose, the 6-carbon sugar, is cleaved into 2-3 carbons before entering the energy-yielding phases of glycolysis. So for every molecule of glucose, we're releasing 6 carbons as carbon dioxide. And in essence, that glucose dissipates in that way. The only thing remaining after oxidation of glucose, the only thing remaining of the glucose molecule is gas released as carbon dioxide. Those carbons are released from glucose. Those 6 carbons are released as CO2. And the energy that was in glucose, that energy remains and is utilized, as we will see. We also, in the process of the Krebs cycle, per acetyl coenzyme A that enters the cycle, we yield 3 NADHs. So we get 3 more NADHs reduced from NAD in the process of oxidizing some of the intermediates of the Krebs cycle. And we end up with another electron-carrying cofactor, FADH2, per cycle of the Krebs cycle. So you see that we're producing lots of reduced electron carriers, NADHs and FADs, as well as releasing CO2s. And the Krebs cycle per cycle releases 1 molecule of ATP. And you think, well, that's not very, 1 molecule of ATP, that's not a lot of energy currency molecule being produced. But the key that you'll see is that these reduced electron carriers, FADH2 and the NADHs, are going to be essential in generating lots more ATP in the electron transport chain. And we'll get to that in a little while. So also in the Krebs cycle, there's a regeneration of oxaloacetate. So keeping these main things in mind, we will look at the Krebs cycle in the next part of this lecture.